Hi, I'm Tabitha Williams, and welcome to What's Eating Harlem. We cover the most exciting community in the world. There's so much happening in Harlem. Let's get started.
Freedom is coming tomorrow.
Get ready, mama, prepare for your freedom.
Freedom is coming tomorrow.
There was a play downtown with two South African actors. One of the members of my theater company who was South African says, Vozer, there's a play with two actors from my country. You guys need to see it. So we go down to a theater in the village and we see this play, and I've never seen acting like this before.
They are Harlem icons. We sit down with Lloyd Williams and Vozer Rivers to discuss part one of their Harlem legacies. Harlem hosted an event celebrating successful Black and Latina women business leaders. All of that and more coming up next.
This program is made possible by J.P. Morgan Chase & Company, the Harlem Community Development Corporation, and by the West Harlem Development Corporation, solutions through collaboration.
These two Harlem icons have been friends for over 70 years, and they have been untiring Harlem advocates for over 60 years. Lloyd Williams and Vozer Rivers are true Harlem heroes.
It's important that when you leave today, you make sure that there's a minimum of two persons that you did not know when you walked in this door that you know when you're going out.
As the president of the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce and the chairman of Harlem Week, Mr. Williams has been a guiding light for business in Harlem. At the Harlem Chamber, he has helped and supported the success of hundreds of Harlem businesses for decades. And being one of the founders of Harlem Week, which started out as a one-day event, he has helped grow it into one of the most successful festivals in the world.
Harlem Week is something that was created 40-some-odd years ago by a unique combination of persons such as Tito Puente and Ozzie Davis and Max Roach and James Baldwin, and we can go on and on, with Percy Sutton being the head of that. The focus of that years ago was recognizing that we were in the doldrums at that time. Things could not have been worse in the urban areas in the world, but particularly in America, and even more so in New York. At that time, abandonment of property, crime soaring, drug epidemic, etc. And many people determined that they would then leave those areas and leave the Harlems of the world, and of course that impacted on Harlem, New York. And Percy Sutton and others said, no, let's come together and let's focus on the positive. Let's focus on what we have. Let's focus on the uniqueness of our community. And we created something called Harlem Day. And in so doing, what we did, we cut a ribbon at 138th Street and 7th Avenue on the fourth Saturday in August. That was 1974. And when we cut that ribbon, day we formally renamed 7th Avenue Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Boulevard. The first time a street in New York City had ever been named after a person of color. And that's how we started Harlem Day.
Mr. Williams developed his leadership abilities by having great mentors, one of whom is his famous godfather.
Malcolm X was my godfather, so I'd start with Malcolm. And I learned so much from him in terms of how to look at life. My mentor, a senior mentor, was Honorable Percy E. Sutton. And I could go on with other names, but the most important person in my life was my grandmother. She is the one who directed me and directed our family in terms of what we need to do. Harlem is a state of mind. Harlem is not a geographical area in Manhattan. Harlem is in Kingston, Jamaica. Harlem is in Roxbury, Massachusetts. It's in East St. Louis. It's in Watts, LA. It's Bristol, England. Wherever there are people of color who have a cultural backdrop, they are Harlemites. So what I love about Harlem is its culture. I love its history. I love its stick-to-itiveness in the most difficult of times.
Percy Sutton also played a very important role in Voza Rivers' life.
I got drafted by the Army, and I knew that I didn't want to go because I didn't believe in the Vietnam War. And I was trying to figure out if I should leave the country and go to Canada like some of my friends did so they could avoid going into a war that we didn't believe in. Percy Sutton, I spoke, he was the borough president, and had a conversation with him about going into the war. And he said, well, you know, Voza, there are certain occupations that are exempt. And it's in, there are certain government contracts they need people still. There are certain occupations like police, firemen, construction workers, engineers, etc. I said, oh, so if you made a decision about any of those positions, I will try and help you find a way to be a part of it so that you don't have to go. The school right here, 135th Street, is very important to me. 135th Street, it was it's still there. It was back then my mother went to the school, my sister went. It was called Harriet Beecher Stowe, Junior High School 136. It was an all-girls school. But you can go in on any Saturday and take a civil service exam. And so that's what I did. I walked, I took a civil service exam, and the only exam that day was for police officers. So I took the exam, and I got a real high mark on the exam. And I told Mr. Sutton, and he said, well, Voza, maybe you should go. What war would you rather be in, local or a war that you didn't believe in? And I decided to go into the police department. He was the borough president. He says, and I'll look after you. I was assigned to something very, very special in the police department, and that was the creation of something called ComStat. ComStat is used to predict, based on statistical information, where crime will probably happen. It is used by the police departments all over the world now, but I worked on it at the New York City Police Department before they adopted it. And then I was assigned to the court system, and I used to sit with judges and district attorneys and legal defense talking about the justice system back then and how police officers testify, how they change stories and be a watchdog to make sure that what really happened is how they testify to what happened.
Not only was Voza a special detective for the NYPD, he was an accountant and later a stage and film producer.
Oh.
In part two of Lloyd Williams and Voza River's Harlem Icons, we pick up the conversation with Voza Rivers, telling the story about the making of Serafina, the stage play, and Serafina, the motion picture.
Freedom is coming tomorrow.
Get ready, mama, prepare for your freedom.
Freedom is coming tomorrow.
There was a play downtown with two South African actors. One of the members of my theater company who was South African, says Voza, there's a play with two actors from my country, you guys need to see it. So we go down to a theater in the village and we see this play, and I've never seen acting like this before. Just two guys, and you would have thought they were 40. The energy level that they exhibited was at a whole nother level, and they sang, they did everything. Show was over, and my friend, his name was Duma, and Duma from South Africa introduced me to the two guys that were on stage. They had just won the Obie Award for Best Actors in a Play, and the play also won an Obie for Best Writing in a Play. And these two guys from South Africa wrote the play, and they had a white director. My name is Voza. V for V-O-Z-A. The show that I saw was Woza, W-O-Z-A. And South Africans, when they pronounce V, it's like W. So they thought that I was from South Africa because I'm with a South African guy. My name is Woza. That's how they pronounce it, like Woza, Woza. And we talked, and I said, where are the black people? We've been here 8 weeks. We sold out all the performances, and we don't see any black people. Where are they? And I said, well, if Duma didn't bring me down here, I would not have known about it. I never heard of the play. I didn't know about you guys, etc. But I'm so pleased. He says, well, what do you do? And I said, I run a little small theater up in Harlem. And he says, we always heard of Harlem. We want to go to Harlem. Can you take us to Harlem? I says, no, I can't, because you guys are here under a production contract with a producer who brought you here. He's responsible for you while you're here. And because it's during the height of apartheid, Americans were prevented from going to South Africa because it would look like we supported the government, and the government was the apartheid government. So they talked and they said, man, we gotta go to Harlem. Now the producer comes up, the white producer, and he looks at the guys and he hears us talking. And he says, these guys are gonna go on tour real soon. And I have to send them back to South Africa. But they're gonna have almost a week to themselves. They can tour and do whatever. And if they happen to go uptown and they happen to do something, it's on them, it's not on me. We brought him up to Harlem. A New York Times reporter wrote, from Soweto to the village to Harlem. It was on the front page of the weekend section. And it hit that play that they won the award from was just okay. What they did in Harlem with the energy, and they saw all those black people. My theater was so small that even though there were two actors, I had to put folding chairs on the stage because the amount of people that wanted to see these guys, because the word of mouth was very strong, it was like a James Brown concert. And people would line up and go around the block waiting to go into the Apollo to see a James Brown concert. Well, that's what happened all of a sudden on Lenox Avenue and 125th Street. The junkies and everybody says, man, what you guys doing up there? All these white people come in and all these black people, what's going on? And it was unbelievable. The guys were great. And they said, Voza, listen, we're going back to South Africa, but we're going to write another play, but it has to come here. You have to produce it. And that's what happened. They went back, they wrote another play. And this is an interesting story. So these two guys go back and they write another play. And they're rehearsing the play in South Africa, and they said, Voza, when are you coming? I said, well, as soon as I get my visa, I'll be there. So I go to get a visa, and I'm denied because they said I was an undesirable because of the other play that I did was against that government. And now I'm trying to go to South Africa. You can't come. So the guys are rehearsing their play, and I told them that I would come, and I can't come. And they said, Bozer, listen to what we're doing. So over the phone, I'm listening to their rehearsals. And they're talking in Zulu and they're singing. I said, oh my God, this is really great. I gotta find a way to bring you guys, even though I can't get into the country to see it, this is really something. I'm feeling, my heart is beating like I'm actually in the studio with them and they're rehearsing. So I come back to down to earth and I go to the funders, New York City Council of the Arts, the New York State Council, and the federal, and tell them that I want to do this play. And they said to me, Boza, you're in Harlem. You recently took over the theater. And you now want to bring South African actors to Harlem. And you got all these black actors who've been here. And how are you going to do that? And we're not going to support it. And I said, for 20 years, I worked with Roger Furman, and our work was to celebrate black history and culture. Roger dies, laid a great foundation for me to expand on, and I want to look at blacks in other countries as part of how we go from the foundation to international. And that's what I'd like to do. No one supported me, no one. Even some of the black theaters and others, they were angry that I was doing this work out of, you know, bringing these actors in. So I can't go to South Africa. I know that this play is special. I saved some money for my kids' college tuition, and I took that money, and I got those airline tickets, and I brought the show in to the theater sight unseen, only from the rehearsals that I heard. Quincy Jones came to see it. Harry Belafonte came to see it. Marion McCabe came to see it. A year later, that show went to Broadway and was nominated for a Tony Award. And I brought it into the world sight unseen. So now these guys go back and it toured all over the country. Five actors in the second play, two in the first, five in the second. So now they said, Boza, we're going to write another play and it's going to be about the kids. And we got to find a way for you to come and see what we're doing. And we got to, you know, break down some doors, but you have to be here to see the play. Luckily for me, Lincoln Center, who came to see the first play that we did that was downtown, became friends. We became friends because they started, what else are you doing up here? So the guys tell me, okay, Boza, you're going to do the play. And I said, okay, now maybe I'll get the support. How many actors? Oh, don't worry about it, Boza. It's a bunch of kids. Don't worry about it. I said, okay, because I know I got a 125-seat theater and they won't tell me how many kids that they're going to bring. There were 35 actors and musicians, and the majority of them were kids, 15, 16, 17 years of age. I said, guys, this is above my pay grade. I cannot, there's no way I could do the play. The artistic director of Lincoln Center, who I became friends with, Greg Moshe, says, Boza, I'm going to South Africa. Why don't you come with me? That's how I was able to be able to go this time, because it's Lincoln Center. And I go and I see the play. Greg says, man, this is the greatest thing I've ever seen. Now he and Bernie Gersten, Bernie Gersten was the executive producer of Lincoln Center and Greg was the artistic director. And they had assumed leadership of Lincoln Center maybe 3 or 4 years earlier. So they were looking for new things and exciting things. And so they saw me as a nice attraction in terms of what I was doing. So I go to South Africa and I see the play. and the rest is history. So the play opens, Serafina opens at Lincoln Center, and because it was too big for my little theater, and they do very well. Tickets sell out immediately. I think they did an 8 or 10 week run initially. They stayed another 6 weeks at the show down at Lincoln Center Theater, sold out performances. And Bernie said, Boza, we recouped all of our money on the show. Now, we can send the actors back to South Africa, or we could think about a bigger space so that your community could see the play. And he said, so what do you think? I said, Bernie, I love it. And you'll be involved because you're a committed artist now, so you don't have to worry. And he went to the Broadway producers who own theaters, and that's how Serafina went to Broadway. But before it went to Broadway, I brought it here to Harlem, to City College, so that students could see it, senior citizens and residents. And no ticket was more than $25. Students saw it free. And I did that. Then the actors went back to South Africa. When they came back, they were on Broadway. And Serafina went to Broadway, was nominated for 5 Tony Awards. And a woman named Irene Gandhi and I became the associate producers, and we took it on the road.
The stage play was so successful that Voza Rivers took it all over the United States, including Los Angeles, where it caught the eye of EGOT, Whoopi Goldberg.
I do not teach communism. I teach history. And history is a beautiful thing. Do you know why?
No.
Because history teaches you where you come from.
I'm getting teary-eyed because that movie was one of my favorites. Oh.
And she said, I have to be in it. And I know the role I want. I want to be the school teacher. And that's what happened. We then went to Spike Lee to see if we could get him to direct it, because that's who we wanted to direct the film. We couldn't get Spike Lee at that time. But we got an investor from an Indian investor who is South African, and he put up the money, and the rest is history.
Besides bringing Serafina back to Broadway, Voza Rivers is now the chairman of the Harlem Arts Alliance, where he is recognized as a local, national, and international impresario for the advancement of arts and culture, whose experience includes award-winning production of theater, film, music, and live events. Gentlemen, we thank and salute you for all your work and love for the Village of Harlem and beyond.
Next time on What's Eating Harlem. See you uptown.